about opening up access to records in New York State, and we focused on Office Suite software and open formats, although that was just, you know, the tip of the iceberg in terms of open standards issues, but we thought that was something everybody could relate to that was illustrative of the general issues. And I've been, you know, following what's been going on for years in this arena. One thing I did at one point in time in relation to that study was do a survey of the government definitions that I could find elsewhere of what an open standard was. There's a lot of private definitions. There's an Open Source Institute definition, I think. There's various association definitions. But even in terms of government definitions, I think at the time, and this is several years back, I found 90 different definitions.
Within New York State?
No, throughout the world, actually. Yeah. Different states had different definitions. Within states, they had different definitions. Within states, to the extent any states had definitions committed to regulation, I don't think there was really much in statutes at the time, the regulatory definitions differed depending on which agency was putting out the definition. And what else is new? So if we're talking about open data, and Professor Hendler earlier today was talking about the 5-star approach to open data, and the first thing is just getting it up on the web, and his third idea was non-proprietary formats, essentially open formats, open, which are a subset of open standards. The question in my mind is, what are we talking about? What is an open standard, and can we agree on it? There have been some really worthwhile publications of data by government agencies within New York State where it's nice to see that data is posted online, but it might be posted in an image scanned PDF, for example, which is not open, which is not accessible. When the federal government first put up the open data website, there was some verbiage on there to the effect that, well, we have this in open formats such as CSV and XML. Well, XML is not automatically an open format. It's, it can be. But the perfect example in the Office suite space is Office Open XML, which followed the open document format standard at the ISO, and at least in its initial iteration, said things like, do this like Word 95 does it, which was closed and not accessible to anybody. And so the, it was valid XML that was produced, but it wasn't, by most definitions of open standards, one cannot say that that was an open standard. So I think in New York State, my perception has been we need to know what we're talking about and start from the perspective that, if we're going to be deciding that we need to put open data out, including in open formats, then, what are we talking about? What are the characteristics of that? There's been some developments this year. There was a huge debate in England, in the United Kingdom, concerning what an open standard is, what an open format is. And the debate really hinged on whether one could require RAND, intellectual property rights in a standard or not. And England, or UK rather, I'm sorry, came down on the side of royalty-free constituting an open standard, that one should not restrict a standard by being able to assert intellectual property rights in the standard. If you have intellectual property rights asserted in a standard, that may not be compatible with open source software, certainly with GPL software. So, I was happy to see that. And, my take on it has always been the definition should be as open as possible. Where the rubber meets the road is really what you require after that. You don't necessarily need to be very onerous in a way that upsets the vendors, or very time limited in a way that upsets vendors as well, by saying we have to do this instantly. But at least let's get the definition right. The best definition I have seen anywhere is the definition that the state of New Hampshire actually enacted this year. Their legislature, they had a few techies join the legislature. So most legislators are lawyers. And these techies decided they were going to run for office and got into office, and they drafted the bill, and the governor signed it, and it was enacted, I think, in March of this year. And it's got a fantastic definition of open standards, open source, open formats, etc. And it basically requires that the state consider those items while the state is procuring technology. I would love to see a statute like that in New York State. From where I sit, I don't have any capability of making that happen.
So how did
the legislators even find out about that statute?
Yes. Yeah, how was the what was in the line? How did they define the standard? They said they have to consider open standards when designing.
They defined open standards, and they defined it very exactingly, and they removed the types of loopholes that have been used for creating lock-in in formats in the past. For example, enabling there to be closed extensions to a format itself. And again, I didn't prepare for this presentation, if you will. I'd say we could just speak among ourselves.
Open standards for all internal work product?
I could find the definition probably.
I'm just curious, was it applied to all their internal work product, or this is just things that they're exposing to the public?
This is actually data created by technology that
saying.
The state...
Yeah.
Purchases or procures in any manner. Let me see, while we're talking, I can see if I can find the language itself.
I'm curious how long the language is. Is it like two sentences, or is it like pages and pages and pages?
No, it's half a page, several bullets.
Okay.
Yeah. In terms of their open standard definition. Let's see. Sure.
I think I'm curious, what about on the Socrates side, like in terms of the, I know you can upload your documents and whatnot, but then you also have the API that you're, I believe there's an API exposed,
yep.
And people can, now that I assume is some sort of open standard, and then how does that work if they upload material that's not in a, like in a proprietary format, or kind of how do you, if someone opened up a Word doc file,
right.
Is that accessible via, what's accessible via the API?
So anything that comes into Socrata is accessible via the API. And how data gets into Socrata, you can do it in a variety of different ways. There's obviously the web interface, but there's an API also for, ingesting.
To get it in,
yeah,
right.
As far as getting it in. So as long as, the data could come in whatever format, as long as it's, being funneled through that
right.
API.
So it's not like somehow... Getting into Socrata is not going to transform anything into an open format. Like there's, you see what I'm getting at? It's not like you can take something like, say, oh, well, we're sticking in the system, and that's somehow automatically going to somehow convert it into
right.
an open format. That's not going to happen?
Well, you can, depends what you want to call an open format,
yeah.
right? But if you want to download the data again, and like I know XML might not be considered an open format, but XML, CSV, whatever you whatever you want. But then I think, what you have to consider on top of that is, how you want to make sure that the system also communicates nicely with other systems so that
mm-hmm.
are not Socrata.
Right.
Right, because you want to avoid having that lock-in.
Exactly.
So
that's
really,
all the whole open standard. I mean,
exactly. And that's the position we're trying to take is that you want to be able to, we want to be on the experience side of the data, and then how the data moves around, and where it's stored, and where it comes from,
mm-hmm.
doesn't
right.
matter. It can be with us, but as long as it's with someone, that's
right.
where we want to. That's where we want to be. So,
I have
the open standards.
I have the bill. It's House Bill 418, 2012, in New Hampshire. The title of the bill is "Relative to the Use of Open Source Software and Open Data Formats by State Agencies." And relative to the adoption of a statewide information policy regarding open government data standards. Okay. I'll get to the definition of open standards. They have a definition of open source software, which has bullet points A through F, and then definition of open standards, bullet points A through H. So open standards means specifications for the encoding and transfer of computer data that is free for all to implement and use in perpetuity with no royalty or fee, has no restrictions on the use of data stored in the format, has no restrictions on the creation of software that stores, transmits, receives, or accesses data codified in such way, has a specification available for all to read in a human-readable format written in commonly accepted technical language, is documented so that anyone can write software that can read and interpret the complete semantics of any data file stored in the data format, if it allows extensions, ensures that all extensions of the data format used by the state are themselves documented and have the other characteristics of an open data format, allows any file written in that format to be identified as adhering or not adhering to the format, and then finally, if it includes any use of encryption or other means of data obfuscation, provides that the encryption or obfuscation algorithms are usable in a royalty-free, non-discriminatory manner in perpetuity and are documented so that anyone in possession of the appropriate encryption key or keys or other data necessary to recover the original data is able to write software to access the data. So it's a pretty detailed definition. I don't think folks think about these things when they're designing systems very often. You know, and maybe it doesn't really impact people's lives directly most of the time. I know for myself, for my children, it did in school. I'm in the Bethlehem Central School District, and they have some great technology they're providing to the students, where the student can work on an assignment at school and then come home and work on the assignment further, and which is wonderful. But the assignment that they were using allowed this student to choose whatever format for the text that they wanted to choose. My daughter chose a format that was a proprietary format. We use open source software at home, and she was able to log on to the school's website just great, access the document, but then as she tried to work on the document from home, the text wasn't fitting in the text boxes, and it was a complete mess because that proprietary format was not provided with the open source software, you know?
You're talking about Word?
I think it was Word that they were using at school. And at home, we tried OpenOffice, we tried LibreOffice, et cetera, you know. I mean, we use Linux at home, so, you know, they don't have Word for Linux. You could use it through, an emulator or what have you, but, if it was easy to use at home, we might have. These kinds of things matter. I was mentioning to Jim earlier that after Hurricane Katrina, we mentioned this in our Strategy for Openness report, but there were some government office buildings that were completely underwater, and there were folks who had taken data, you know, for whatever purpose, because they were in some satellite office or what have you, and they had access to data, and they were, we can actually restore that data. We've got some usable data that we can use for this governmental function, and they tried to load it into other governmental systems, and the data was not readable because the formats were not compatible. So these do have real world implications, and I just think, to me, it's the cart before the horse when one decides, let's have an open data platform without deciding first of all what kind of data we're going to put on there. Are we doing a garbage in, garbage out kind of situation? I like the order that Tim Berners-Lee put his stars on that cup, because I've always been one of these people who's thinks don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. And so to the extent you can get anything up there that you have right now, that's great. That's some openness. You're moving in the right direction. But, to the extent you're going to be building any kind of extensive platform, maybe the creation of the data and how the data is being created and maintained should be considered. And this is very important to the state archives. The archives worked with us on the Strategy for Openness report, and it was actually jointly issued by the CIO's office and then OFT and the state archives. And it, for formats of the data that the state creates to be closed drives the archivists crazy, because they've got to try to, retain certain state data for hundreds of years in some instances and have it be accessible. And the way the data is created originally can be just as important for archival purposes as what the final presentation view looks like. A perfect example for everybody is, for example, an Excel spreadsheet or any kind of a spreadsheet. If you have a nice PDF printout of the final version of the spreadsheet, you've got one set of information, but you don't have the formulas that led to, the creation of that spreadsheet, et cetera. So much less the metadata. And even from an archival perspective, they were concerned about the metadata, even in terms of whether the information was captured, if you could see who worked on that document. So 100 years from now, some historian looking at it would see, this was a multi-agency project that, what have you, and might be interested in that fact. So again, I didn't have any presentation. I just wanted to, hit a reminder that I think these issues need to be considered in terms of any kind of move towards openness. And I don't know what your thoughts are on it.
Yes. I'm curious if anyone else is using RDS or what they're doing with it, and just sort of getting into that myself. So, in terms of...
Maybe we should say who we all are. Actually, it might help. Again, I'm John Cody from ITS, but
I work for a research arm of DOH, and so I run websites for them.
All right.
My name's Paul Fernhout, and I'm a software developer. I don't work for a government agency, though, although I am a trustee of my local historical society. Mm-hmm. So I am thinking about some of these issues from that perspective as well, like what kind of website should they have and so forth. You know, even now, I maintain the website that I inherited from somebody from somewhere else. And, you know, question in my mind, you know, I just updated the officers page, but should we have the old officers, you know, from previous years there? And how can I do that easily? You know, and also what, you know, how would I describe them? And how would I put a few there if I don't have the whole history of them? So, you know, these issues can come up in a variety of contexts.
Yeah, as a lawyer, I'll tell you, I see, you know, premature taking something down as an issue all the time. You know, an OGS contract ends and it's immediately taken off their website. But I need to see it because, you know, what happened, what I'm looking at in terms of what happened a few months ago, it's relevant. It's gone, you know. The same thing with different policy iterations. You know, if somebody says, well, what I was doing was within policy, but now we have a new policy. Where's the old one? Nobody kept a copy of it, you know. But the time period in question, that was the policy that was applicable. That's the one we need, you know.
So one thing I was thinking of, for example, was maybe using, you know, GitHub to host the website because it's free to begin with. But on the other hand, you know, GitHub is a service someone else is providing, and it could, in theory, go away tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Of course, the great thing is if I have it in Git, I could move it somewhere else. But also, like GitHub, I can't track, you know, who comes to the site unless I put, like, a tracking bug like, you know, Google, you know, with Google Analytics. But then, of course, I get into that thing, you know, that I'm involved with, you know, why should people come into my historical site be tracked by Google.
I mean, right.
So there are a lot of things to think about, you know, as one tries to move to those systems.
Hey, Ben.
I work for an environmental conservation application developer there, job application. It's kind of interesting because, you know, with HTML5, I don't know if you're aware, there are several video standards out there, which is the reason they haven't quite settled on one standard yet, because they're are some entities who have a proprietary on the standards, like the
H. But they're still using H.264 as a standard.
Yeah. Right, right. But then there's a couple other open standards that they're trying to work on. And I'd just love to see how this ends, you know, the competition there. How do you compete with the, you know, proprietary brand?
H.264 is proprietary, right?
But it's been open. It was opened up last year. There's no... right now, you're allowed to use it. That could change, but you're free to use it. However, you know, I think they saw this with, you know, with some of the others, with OGG and
right.
some of the other
yeah.
standards out
That's
there,
the other, yeah.
and they intentionally opened it up. So that is kind of becoming the standard right now. That could change, but it's unlikely at this point.
Okay, I'm Pat Lynch, and I'm from the Department of Health also. And I'm the project manager for Metrics, which is the open data catalog. We built it within 3 months because Dr. Shaw is a researcher, and when he was in the private sector, could not get at our data very easily. And the first thing he asked for is an inventory and for us to start putting our open data out. We are now in a Socrata proof of concept. We're just about 6 weeks into the platform. We did a lot of research and talked to data.gov, and it was recommended that to start out in an open government platform that Socrata gives you a lot of the features at low cost, and we have very little resources. There's only like two of us. We're getting a little bit more staffing, but why we are doing the proof of concept is primarily for the visualizations, particularly the maps, and also the APIs, the application programming interfaces, and we want to, we want to go.
Well, I'm doing Wadsworth Center, so yeah.
Well, it is for DOH employees, of which Wadsworth is part of it.
Sure, yeah. Recently.
And first, we have a three design release phase the first release, and actually, Marcus, I'm not going to steal your thunder, but is from Socrata, and was in looking at our site. And I have something to give you as an.
Pat, how much massaging of the data did you have to do before you could post it?
Excellent question. And that's where my point was, and I'm so sorry. I will be quick. I was given a little bit of a plug, so pardon me. A lot. What we're finding, we have four data sets. I just want to say one more thing before I answer that, because it's very pertinent. Dr. Shah also asked us that we don't just release the data, that we have metadata, meaning a data dictionary, overview, benefit and research questions that go with it, and meta tags. We also are doing a visualization, a map if we can, or some kind of trend line or bar charts. So given that as what we were asked to do, we took the data files that are in the metrics data catalog, and we're very proud of that. But then when we put it into Socrata, what we quickly realized is those data files were very operationally formatted and needed, and in mainframe ease. And that we are spending, and that's what we've been doing the last 4 to 6 weeks, quite frankly. It isn't, I mean, we're doing some pretty design graphics and all that kind of stuff. But working with our program data owners on going from an operational data file format to more of a public-facing data file and putting it in plain English. And in the Socrata tool, you're able to take some of your data dictionary and put it right into the column headings. So we want to do that. We have a suggestion for Socrata that we think that they're about where you put all your metadata can be a little bit more customizable. I mean, you can put in all your materials, but it's kind of on the bottom. So unless we can have flashing lights and everything, but we're still concerned people won't go there. But we're working with Socrata on that. And the other biggest challenge, quite frankly, is governmental employees are used to using their data for operational purposes and for report generation, not for public facing. And so the first thing we asked them when they put their data into, our open data platform, we say, so what's your public health message? What is the message? Who are your primary stakeholders? Because it could be the general public, it could be researchers, academia, other governmental agencies. Who is? Or is it multiple stakeholders? And you kind of need to understand that as you're working on your data cleansing and your visualizations. And, it's like a deer looking at headlights when you ask that question, quite frankly. So what our challenge is, and what we wanted to work more with Socrata on, is what are the tips of best practices for making governmental employees, more comfortable with this public-facing open government strategy? Because everybody thinks that everybody wants to share their data. Well, they don't. Quite honestly, because my pitch and George Javits, who will be here shortly, technically, the first thing we have to do is convince people that open government is a good thing. And that, there is a substantial risk that the data can be used incorrectly. But if we have the metadata, and if we have a message that goes with that data, the risk is definitely lessened significantly.
I don't know whether you personally, either of you, worked on HIPAA compliance within DOH, but anybody who's heard of HIPAA knows that it was an enormous effort. I actually was brought into the state originally to work on HIPAA, so I've been looking at standards issues for a long time. And the idea behind the HIPAA is an enormous statute, but the part, the tail that wagged the dog, was the part in terms of standardizing billing systems originally. And at the time, it was estimated there were 400 different medical billing systems in use in the country, and they couldn't speak with each other. Mm-hmm. And we know what an enormous effort it was to get them to actually be using consistent standards. And there are all kinds of health kinds of standards, like HL7 and what have you, that needed to be used in consistent ways and information transmitted in consistent ways so the systems could speak with each other. When we talk about the type of data that, that you're talking about producing, and you know, you have stakeholders who are not necessarily just those folks in New York State who are concerned with that data, but what about folks doing the same thing you are but in other parts of the country or the world? And you run into things like even, you know, numerically in terms of listing dollars, another country might have use a comma where we use a period or something. So that's why I always say step back and look at, you know, the extent to which you can have consistent standards. And I don't know whether for the type of data that you're putting out there in metrics, there is any kind of consistent standard for even formatting that data, naming things, you know, naming conventions, date formats and what have you. You know, you may not even be there yet. To me, I see all of that as necessary groundwork.
Right. No, there's... Yeah. We haven't gotten funding for it, but we've asked, and hopefully we will in the budget, is a data classification program. We strongly feel, due to our inventory, that you're absolutely right. There's even for redaction and de-identification, there's a lot of informal practices. There are a lot of similarities between the practices. But health is extremely diverse, you know, from Wadsworth to the public health and the local public health departments to environmental health to the Office of Health Insurance Programs to the Office of Health Information Technology and Transformation with electronic health records and an all-payers database. I mean, it's extremely diverse, and we are trying, particularly with the Medicaid data warehouse and APD, to come up with some of those things. So that's one approach. But the other approach is really APIs. And the APIs, if you have the six or seven open standard ways of importing your data into you know, a tool like Socrata, the API is what helps making it more open and generic. And again, if you have the meta documentation, particularly a data file layout and a data dictionary, that's a good, it's like a middle step without going through the substantial challenges. Because when I was at the Office of Temporary and Disability Assistance, they tried to bring in health, OTDA, and Office of Children and Family Services, just to come up with a common data dictionary for health and human services, and it failed.
Yeah.
Because for simple, even simple client demographics, there's different definitions that are used by different computer systems. So that's why we were looking at APIs as one way of getting around that.
And you are...
My name is Marcus Louie. I'm with Socrata, data solutions architect over there. So we are very interested in standards. So there's a number of, I think, number of great opportunities that you can do with open data, whether that's doing benchmarking, right, if you have, whether it's, say, performance of cities or agencies and you want to compare things, then you have that ability to everyone having their data in the same format, then whatever system you're using, you can actually do that comparison, or whether it's with schemas or data models. Right, because I was going to say, because then, you know, an application, like a developer, can do things like, I'm going to create an application, say, for the universe or for, like, the city of Chicago, and say that's on, like, pothole data, right? I'm just making something up. Then another city has pothole data. They only have to write that application once. They don't have to go and redo that, refigure out how to, you know, look at this schema, look at this layout, do the whole thing over again. They write that application once, then you're good to go for whatever city. So, We really believe in the standards also. And just a little announcement, too, we just also open-sourced it.
I'm sorry,
you open-sourced the crowd?
Yeah, well, it's the announcement. We're going to do a release in Q1.
Awesome, wow. Good for you.
So, yeah, yeah. Thanks. So, yeah, and...
they are an awesome government.
Yeah, so, I mean, I would love to, for people who are interested, I'd love to continue to have that conversation with you because it's, you know, we're still designing it, and we want to make sure that how it comes out is going to be something that's going to fit what people are looking for.
Okay, I have two questions. First of all, what is the magic that Socrata brings? Is it really focused on the visualization? Is it transforming, interpreting the data in some way so that it can be reused or what have you? And then my second question is, how does the open sourcing of Socrata relate to what the U.S. federal government and India are trying to do together in terms of an open API? I forget the name of it. I think it was in one of Jim Hendler's slides.
Yeah. LGPL.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So on the first part, you know, I think of our core as being on the data experience side. It's like really the last mile. If you think of the first mile as just like getting the data out there to be shared, and you think about the last mile as being like the consumption side of it, and whether that's, you know, for multiple audiences, whether that's for a developer, whether it's for an academic, an analyst, or whether it's just, you know, private citizen, like, that's where we want our core to be. So, you know, whatever format that the data are in, or whatever system that the data are stored in, whether that's, you know, with CCAN or OGPL or Sakrai, even it doesn't matter as much to us as what we're able to enable people to do with that data in the end. So that's where we feel that's where we want to spend our time. On the second part, I think we all have. All of us in that space have a similar interest of trying to get the data open and out there, and part of that is needing to work together on, you know, how do we move data between systems in the right way. So if someone has like a CCAN data catalog, say a city is using that, and someone else, like say a county or a state's using another system, how do you get them to share that data regardless? Like, how do you federate that data regardless of what system you're using? I think it has benefits for both parties if you can do that. So that's
cool. Well, I have nothing else. Like I said, I didn't prepare a presentation or anything.
Yeah.
There's certain topics to discuss. If anybody else wants to discuss anything on these topics, we can. Otherwise,
I just have an add-on response to the question you asked before. It takes us from when we first start talking with the program data owner minimum of 2 to 4 months to get the data in the proper condition to go on a data catalog.
What steps are needed? What is the improper condition can look like?
Well, the first thing is to make sure that it is truly public data. Mm-hmm. So we have a thorough discussion with an attorney from that program area that sits with us. Because, you know, the flip side of public data is to make sure that privacy is protected. And now we believe in data sharing and data linking. Dr. Shaw wants to have a hackathon. That's why we're here, to learn from you guys. But the more you do the data sharing and the data linking, that's where your privacy now may become a little hazier. So looking at the personal data, it becomes very, very critical to us. So we usually have 2 meetings just to talk about what is personal identifier data. And it could be, you know, a person in Hamilton County who went for colon cancer operation. Well, there might be only one person that went. So we're totally redacting that information.
Right.
You know, even though we don't have any personal information out there, just that there was one procedure in a small area is the level of discussion that we're going to. The other is just getting the data file in proper order and the metadata. Everybody thinks that people document what their data is. Well, they don't. And more importantly, we have an overview document that says what the data is not, meaning is it validated by anyone? Is it just self-reported? Is it a phone survey data? We provide the data collection document so that you can see, if you're a researcher, how good was the methodology in collecting the data. You know, these are all the things that need to really be considered and shared.
What about completeness of the data also, Pat? You wouldn't want an empty field skewing the entire results because it came out a zero or something, for example, when it really wasn't a zero, but nobody bothered to fill it in.
Well, and that's the last step is quality assurance. And I've got to say, I don't mean this as a plug, but it is. You know, when we put the data file up and you look it on your PC, it's one thing. We put it in Socrata, and now you're looking at it again from a real public-facing visualization standpoint. And we took a data set, and information has to be reported on a weekly basis by a particular type of facility. And we put it up, and all of a sudden, we see a dozen that it's been a year to 6 months since they've reported, and they're supposed to report every week. Now, the question is, how good is that data? So, you know, we're going to be focusing on those outliers. You know, most facilities are doing, but now that we're putting the information out there, we want people to have the most relevant, timely information, because that, we think, is just as important as complete. You know, that's part of the complete definition, I should say.
What some governmental entities are moving to is actually live data or as close to it as you can. So, for example, I don't know if this is a Socrata site or not, but I think it's Seattle, Washington, that posts crime data. But they have an hour lag, so that gives the time for the police officers to actually respond to the reported crime and deal with it, or whatever, maybe a traffic incident or what have you, but whatever the incident is. But within an hour, that data is posted online.
It used to be real time. So as soon as the 911 operator completed the phone call and completed the transaction, like the transaction being the record of the incident, it would be posted on the website. But the problem that it ran into was that there would be ambulance chasers who were monitoring the application, and so they had to do that intentional lag where they'd dial it back.
What happens to those historical statistics as that starts piling up and piling up? Do you know? I mean,
historical statistics about where the crimes are happening.
They're all pending there. Alrighty. Anybody else have anything else?
Well, I guess one thing is about standards is that I guess the joke is there's so many to choose from, right? But another issue is that, you know, there's different types of standards about different things. So a lot of the things I think people, you know, start out struggling with are sort of technical standards for how are we going to display hierarchical data, which a lot of this, you know, and then the next one is then how is it going to be linked together. I mean, those are very basic things. So you could say we're going to use JSON, we're going to use XML, we're going to use a flat file format that's encoded in a certain way or something like that. But it seems like the really more difficult ones, you know, to deal with, like Pat is raising, you know, are this semantic level of, you know, what do things mean? And it sounds like, you know, she's going a lot of effort to try to document
and
stuff.
And George Javits, the technical lead as well.
And certainly as time goes by, those things become more critical because, you know, I guess, you know, one of the presentations, you know, they were talking about what is burglary, you know, in a different country, right? So, and we disagree about that even now. But from a historical standpoint, then it's even harder to figure out, you know, what did people mean 10 years ago or 20 years ago and so forth. There's a great book called Data and Reality by the late William Kent, and he talks about a lot of the issues of trying to, you know, kind of get at the semantic level and the fact that reality is sort of continuous, but our data models are always very discrete, you know, and that, you know, again gets to the point that Pat was talking about trying to you know, figure out how do you label something, you know, and it's very hard because, you know, people can be lots of things and lots of different times and, you know, medical conditions can probably have continuums and, you know, all sorts of things. So how...
And there's probably a lot of subjectiveness, I would think, even to, you know, what one would interpret, even if you had a consistent definition. I'm thinking of something like campus crime statistics. There's a disincentive to load up your data with lots of crime statistics so that, you know, you're about to send your son or daughter to college and you say, well, I don't want them to go there, you know.
Right.
So maybe the definition of the crime is exactly the same as used in the other campus, but maybe the reporting is done a little differently, you know.
Sure, and same thing, medical diagnosis. I saw one chart that was showing that ADHD diagnoses sort of increased as you got to the East Coast, you know, especially focusing on, like, you know, kind of Washington almost as a hub. And you look at it and you're like, that can't be. But it obviously has to be an artifact of, you know, how it's diagnosed or something like that.
And medicine historically was looked at as, the standard was what the local standard was in terms of treatment and what have you, right? And the health folks could speak to this more than I could, but it's, you know, there wasn't one universal medical treatment standard. It was, you know, what was something reasonable to do within the community.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, maybe negligence in one community would be not negligence in another community.
Right.
From a legal perspective. So,
and so now we're seeing
we're starting
more
to
these standards connect up or something.
Yeah, as more data is exposed.
As
more data is exposed, I think the standards become more widely have wider coverage areas. You know.
Right. One thing that Alan Kay said, who worked on Smalltalk computer language, was any standard with more than, I forget what his number was, three lines is ambiguous.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that wasn't in that New Hampshire definition that would have been nice is to say that, you know, an ideal standard has a open implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Because
right.
The implementation is generally, not always, but fairly ambiguous, whereas even the, you know, I've worked from human-written standards, whether MPEG stuff or whatever, and it can be really confusing sometimes to try to figure out what people meant. I was on one team that was helping develop the XSLT standards, and there was always stuff going back and forth about what exactly does this phrase mean, you know, and then we'd go and we'd ask the people who were on the standards committee, and they would be like, this is kind of what we meant, but you know, how would you know by looking at the text sometimes? So without a reference implementation, that's
right.
It's kind of hard to do.
And you get into questions of what's the appropriate reference implementation. I mean, if
you're
talking about
open
document format, if you had chosen, you know, the OpenOffice product, maybe that's not what some folks would think of as sufficiently open because of the governance of that project.
That's a very good point. Yes, the governance aspect of it.
Which hence has led to the creation of LibreOffice, for example.
Right.
So, you know, if you were to say that product was your reference implementation, maybe someone would take issue with it. Yeah, these are complex issues, and again, I think this is the ground floor for thinking through. It's not necessarily the cart before the horse, but I'm just concerned about, you know, whether government entities go too far towards locking themselves into a certain type of feed and production and publication of data before they start running into problems where, well, you know, we can't use that data because it's not open in this fashion, and maybe that's something that should have been thought of ahead of time.
So you don't see an international standard happening
on the horizon? I don't know. It's, you know, even the application programming interface, it sounded as though the federal government in India decided to create some international standard similar to what Socrata is doing. Socrata, maybe in response to that, said, well, okay, we're going to open source our standard. Now you have competing application programming interfaces, you know.
Well, hopefully we can all agree.
Well, ideally, yeah, that's the thing. It's kumbaya. That's what we all need, right?
But it sounds like, I mean, if you
and you can still make money.
Yeah.
Right.
But if you look at life and practice or even nature, I mean, you know, there's so many different types of creatures in nature, you know, that all fit in different situations, you know, like a cat, you know, is very good at climbing trees and stuff, but a dog is, you know, got really bigger jaws. And I mean, they all have their advantages and, you know, I guess I should say they all have their characteristics that can be strengths or weaknesses in different situations.
Right.
So, I mean, I can wonder if we're ever going to see, you know, a unified standard for different things. I mean, the URL, though, is one thing that I think has become a standard. Although even itself has a variety of permutations, but that idea of the URL, maybe more than anything, is something that I think is still percolating through our society. And one thing I was thinking about that in the context of an application, an open source application, was the sense that I kind of led a talk here last year at Capital Camp. It was more a discussion. And what I was trying to get at the issue is, you know, is the web everything, or is there still a role for desktop apps? And in thinking about that, I really came to the conclusion that it's getting to the point where if something doesn't have a URL associated with it, or if an application doesn't have a URL for what it's doing, it's like broken. It's almost like a cultural change. And the reason I think of that is because when you have a URL that's associated with something, you can give it to somebody. You know, you can email it to them. You can shorten it and Twitter it. You could do whatever. And people can get at that piece of data. But if you have a file somewhere and it doesn't have a URL with it, then whatever format it's in, it's essentially almost inaccessible. You really can't get at it unless, I mean, you could have somebody ship it to you or something, but, you know, I don't really know where I'm going with this line of speaking, but it's just this notion that there are these other aspects of standards that are emerging, like the URL.
Well, that's really interesting, though, because, you know, I mean, you as a government agency, you can come up with an app, but people still have to download it.
Right.
You know, whereas if you have a URL.
And they have to navigate that app, too. So let's say you're looking for information about something. You found it. Now how do you communicate that with someone else?
It has to be available on their platform.
Right. And unless the data that you found has some kind of URL that you can say, here's how to get back to it. You know, because sometimes I've seen things where someone says, go to this website, click here, click here, click here, and then, you know, enter this. Now you have the data. But, you know, that's kind of a roundabout way to get at it. But then, of course, you get the fact that URLs, you know, sort of rot over time. You put URLs up, and now you change your underlying services, and the URLs disappear. So there are some standards that are emerging to discuss how do you make permanent, you know, URLs, URIs, really. I mean, this variety of terms that get to that. So, yeah, that's another aspect of the standard part. And I know I'm very disappointed when I find... when I look for government information and someone points to it and it's gone. And I'm like, wait a minute, this is a government website. The data was there last year. People talk about it. Why isn't it there anymore? You know, I understand why that happens. You know, I've worked with websites, you know, long enough to see you come up with a new approach or you want to switch platforms or something. It's very hard to maintain the old one. But I guess that's another aspect of the standards and the historical.
Yeah, I wish there was somebody here from the state archives, because I know one thing that they try to do, at least for certain websites, is scrape the website and keep a copy so that if it does get taken down or to have you, they have the information.
Right. Archive.org has been talking about that. I mean, they do scrape all these websites, but the fact is, you know, a scraped website also isn't the same as a live website, too, because there's so many ways you can go into some of these things and stuff.
I like your idea, though, just because, I mean, you can come up with keywords within URLs as well, you know? So, like, news or events or something, you could grab them all based on a location and merge if you all have the same format.
Right, and there are some standards that are emerging for trying to essentially construct, you know, URLs in such a way it's almost like a set of commands, you know, at the end to retrieve certain pieces of data. But from a standpoint of someone who's done actually mostly desktop apps, you know, I keep looking at them like, that's a big disadvantage to a desktop app, you know, that it's a cultural thing. It's thinking, I'm looking at, let's say, a 3D model. Let's pick something that seems very non-URL-ish. But it would be really cool if I could, you know, say, oh, here is a way to get at this 3D model, a particular orientation, you know, in some context with particular lighting, and then make that available to somebody else who could then go from that standpoint. You know, and that's an example of, you know, I mean, desktop applications aren't designed that way. And I think that's one of the reasons the web is starting to take over, because these URLs are such a standard to transmit. And so it was a brilliant innovation, I mean, by Tim Berners-Lee and the people around him to come up with that. And I guess what I'm trying to say is I think that innovation drives so much, and it's maybe underappreciated so far as far as the revolutionary potential of that as it percolates. And kind of maybe we take it for granted at this point. You know, we see it on the web, but it's sort of still diffusing as an idea.
It's interesting to take account of, you know, what changes the web has wrought just in your personal life. I moved at one point in time, And I had all of this documentation, things from law school, you know, guides and manuals to different things, and, you know, different state bar association requirements and documents like that. And I was able to toss out an enormous amount of material and not have to move it, because I thought, well, that's on the web now. That's on the web. That's on the web. I don't need this anymore. It's on the web, you know. And it was just, you could physically see what a difference it has made to remove an entire room full of data from your own personal store, you know.
Of course, that has its downside, too, because if people don't have their local copies, you know, how many copies are there, and do they agree, you know, and is there an audit trail? That was another aspect of standards that's kind of interesting, and that's an advantage of, like, Git as an archiving system. It has a series of checksums, you know, as you go through, and so each new version you make checksums back to the, you know, and it, of course, anything is defeatable, you know, with enough computational power, but it certainly makes it harder to sort of alter the historical record.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you have a lot of people and they have a lot of systems like that, then you could be more sure about the integrity of the data. I guess I think that may be an upcoming challenge.
Yeah, I was going to say that's a topic for a different discussion, but... Are we at the end of our time?
Standards for integrity, then that gets back into the standards issue.
Yep. All right. I don't know what the next session is, but anyway, I appreciate the fact that several of you were interested in this topic, and I certainly still am, so we'll see where the state winds up going.
Thanks, John.
Yes, thanks.